driver's got a plan for you. Don't you worry, don't you worry.
Hi everyone, welcome back. Hope you all made new friends on your break. It's part of the dream. I am very, very excited to introduce our final session of the day. It's been such a phenomenal day, and this last hour I know will be amazing as well. This will be a masterclass, Close Up, with cinematographer James Laxton. And the panel will be, or the masterclass, sorry, will be moderated by another cinematographer, Maya Bankovic. Maya is a brilliant and prolific DP. She's based in Toronto, and I'm so grateful that she jumped on board for this and was completely instrumental in getting this class together. With roots in experimental filmmaking and documentary, she draws from a variety of techniques that cross genre lines, though primarily works on feature films and in television. Her recent films include the amazing The Prison in 12 Landscapes, directed by Brett Story, and Michael Shannon John, by longtime collaborator, director Chelsea McMullen. She also worked recently on Joyce Wong's debut feature film, Wexford Plaza, which is premiering at the Torino Film Festival and having its North American premiere at Slamdance. She shot Below Her Mouth, directed by April Mullen, which premiered at TIFF in the fall. And she also is a DP on Catherine Reitman's new series, which is also on CBC, Working Moms. James Laxton is an American cinematographer working in independent film and a longtime collaborator with director Barry Jenkins. He was nominated for a Film Independent Spirit Award for his work on Jenkins' first film, Medicine for Melancholy. He was director of photography on another of the most acclaimed writing and directing feature debuts of recent years, David Mitchell's The Myth of the American Sleepover, which had its world premiere at South by Southwest in 2010 and went on to play the 2010 Cannes Film Festival. Some of James's additional credits include Peter Sattler's Camp X-Ray and Kevin Smith's Tusk and Yoga Hosers. Amazing. Most recently, as some of you may know, James was the cinematographer on Barry Jenkins' Moonlight, for which he is nominated for an Academy Award. Another thing we'll all be watching collectively, though maybe in separate spaces next week, and I know we'll be cheering really loud. He currently lives in Los Angeles with his wife and two dogs, and in his spare time, he enjoys making artisanal bread. I love the internet. So this is a bit of a dream come true. I can't quite believe we're here, but to have James with us, whose vision I think literally changed the world this year, and like our previous panel, offered a different way to tell a story. His work on Moonlight is a display of immense power and skill, and most profoundly for me, an affirmation that it is possible to tell raw, hard stories and take care of characters as we do so. His ability to hold people with the camera and never let go offers something that I think this year was truly transformational, and I cannot wait for him to tell us all about it. So please join me in welcoming Maya and James.
Let me cry.
Quite the intro. Thank you. James, thank you so much for making your way to Toronto for this.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me. Thanks for coming, guys. Appreciate it.
And thank you all for being here. I would like to formally just also congratulate you on all the success that you've personally had with Moonlight.
Thank you.
ASC nomination, which is a huge milestone for any DP, Independent Spirit Award nomination, LA and New York Film Critics Awards, and of course the Academy Award nomination, which is
it's crazy. Thank you very much.
Stunning achievement. So congratulations. Let's begin. We were chatting a little bit just now in the back, and I would love to actually start by talking about Moonlight. It has this personal touch to it. You can sort of feel the human element behind the camera. It doesn't feel like a massive apparatus behind this film in terms of the filmmaking machine that we sometimes feel with such successful films. And that presence, I think, behind the camera is very obviously you. You were camera operating on this film. Can you talk a little bit about how you think that benefited this project?
Yeah, I mean, there's two things to talk about in that question. First is the idea of voice a little bit, about who we are as cinematographers and how who we are finds its way onto the screen, which is a very theoretical conversation. So we'll get into it as we go along. But I think it's interesting with Moonlight. I sort of feel, you know, for example, the intro of also working with Kevin Smith. I feel with Moonlight, on some level, I sort of found what one might call their voice. It was a very personal film for me, as obviously it was for Barry in a massive way. But even for myself, it was an opportunity to sort of dig deep into the, you know, caverns of who I am as a human being and try to sort of find how that translates to the screen. So that that gaze that we all have on some level, no matter who we are, it was something I was trying to sort of navigate and digest for the first time in my short career. And I sort of feel like I found it. I hope I did. I think I did. And I'm happy about that. It makes me feel good because it takes a while. So that's part of it. And then to speak about the just the apparatus that we all make films by and how that can be flexible or not flexible. You know, something that I share with Barry is this want and need for images that have an authentic connection. Like when I look at the monitor or the dailies or whatever we're doing, and something feels untrue to me. And when I guess what for me as a cinematographer, what that means is, you know, when the light looks like it's lit, or you know, when it just has a quality to it that seems untrue, or when the camera's doing something that just looks like I don't know, just a very contrived move or some version of that, you know, something, you know, checks in my stomach and says no, wrong. And a lot of that has to do, and the way we fix that or navigate that has a lot to do with trying to allow ourselves present the process by which we're making films be flexible. Because, you know, I feel like I'm still starting to make films. But when you're first starting to make films, you're going to make mistakes. I've made so many. And to be able to sort of in that moment go, that was wrong, let's change what we're doing, is really important and kind of critical to my process and I don't know how I've sort of started making films.
So does that mean keeping the blocking kind of loose? What does that mean on a practical level for you?
So that means a lot of things. It means, I guess, to talk about light for a second, it means not having a lot of gear in the room. That's sort of important. So with Moonlight, I made a rule for myself that I could only have one light in the room. And I could only have, maybe I could put some maybe diffusion on it and control it with flags and things like that. But that was sort of a rule for me. I never told Barry about that. But it was something that I needed for myself to sort of start there and say, okay, that's important.
Did he ever ask for more?
No, never. No. I don't think so. That's a good question. I don't know. I don't think he'd ever did.
He let you get away with it.
No, he did. Yeah, no, very much so. I think, no, but I think we like that same thing. You know, I had lights out windows and things like that to sort of, you know, light the space, so to speak. That's a sort of an approach a lot of people have these days, is you light the space, not the people. And so I do a bit of both in my work. I light the space first, and then I'll place a little key light somewhere to sort of massage that into something that sort of feels good for me. But yes, to go back, one light in the room allowed me to sort of go, okay, that light's there. It's in the corner of that space. I can't look that way, but I can look kind of anywhere else. And if that meant an actor moved or changed an idea or like all of a sudden I just felt as a camera operator the need to push in, pull out, walk to my right to find a different angle that maybe silhouetted the character against a window that just sort of evoked an emotion that felt appropriate for what we were up to. I needed as, you know, myself needed the space to do that. It's funny. I think a lot of directors, a lot of filmmakers think the DP is always fighting them for like wanting more technical stuff in the space. And we're going to battle the director or whomever, and like, because we're going to want to light five different ways and blah, blah, blah. I sort of come from a different perspective. Is like, I kind of want the space for myself. And that has a little bit to do with another theory we can talk about, which is I feel like light should always be a slave to camera. I personally feel like the way a camera moves, the proximity to it, to subject, the lens choices, these are things that, for me, at least right now, in my personal life and professionally, like those have more impact for me than the different diffusion or whatever might be the different cut of the light that comes from a flag. Like those things, the light, the camera trumps light for me currently anyway.
Yeah, this is a camera-centric mm-hmm. film.
Yeah, and I think I'm a camera-centric DP. I mean, I come from that as well, by the way. Like, that, maybe that's part of it. I don't come from the lighting department. I come from working my way up from a loader and second and things like that.
Mm-hmm. And the optics and how that's making you feel, if it's a handheld sequence, if it's a Steadicam sequence.
Yeah, those are things that just, to me, have more value for some weird reason. I don't know. Maybe that's not true for everyone. It probably isn't, but for me it is.
That's awesome to hear you say that. I think a great example of that is just the very first shot in the film that I think mm-hmm. is about 3 minutes long. And it's a Steadicam shot, a single take, and we see 360 all around the neighborhood. And me, you know, I can watch a film, but also there's like that second tier of my brain that's operating as a filmmaker and watching, saying like, okay, they're showing us the space. There are no walls. They're sort of breaking down all the walls. There's no gear, so I know there's no gear. We're just seeing this place. Mm-hmm. There's no artifice to it, mm-hmm. you know. And so I register that, and then I'm just watching again.
Yeah, I mean that first scene in Moonlight is all about the whole global concept of what Moonlight is all about on a visual level, which is immersion. And that was this idea that we sort of, let's, at the very beginning of this movie, get the audience as close to the characters as possible and hopefully engage them on a level that makes them feel as if they're connected and they have a deep, deep emotional engagement with the character. And we just felt like that was, for us anyway, that was all about this concept of immersion.
And so as the camera operator, you're kind of feeding off the energy of the actors in that in moments, especially in that maybe that last scene we can talk about as well, where where there are tight quarters and they're performing in a way. In that moment, they're performing for you, in a sense, because you are the eye and you're capturing it now for the rest of us. But it has to be filtered through you first.
That's interesting. Yeah, that's interesting. I don't know that I have a conscious idea of that in that moment. I see what you're saying. It's not wrong. I guess I just don't conceptually know that that's true in my mind in that moment, but you're right. A good example of that actually is a story that Barry talks about a lot. In story two, when Naomi Harris comes to kind of greet her son in that courtyard out front of her apartment, and she says, you know, I'm your mama, ain't I, directly into the lens, and then the camera kind of keeps going and runs back to the front door with her. You know, that was a shot that was intended to sort of cut at, I'm your mama, ain't I, cut. But I think for Barry and for myself and for Naomi as well, there was this sort of like very deep emotional thing happening, and Barry never called cut. And we were all just very much, you know, in that moment. And we kind of just kept going. And I think what you're talking about, this idea of that connection between the cinematographer and the actor and that intimate space that we share, I guess you can just sort of say it felt good and you just never didn't want to say stop yet.
Because if you have a camera grip, and bless them, but grabbing a camera off your shoulder right away, it can break that sometimes.
That's interesting. Yeah, I don't do that, actually, because I do that easy rig thing, which, I don't know, lots of old school camera operators don't like, but I'm not sure if you're familiar with it, but it's this weird strappy thing you wear on your chest, and it's got this little arm that comes up behind your back, and it dangles this camera like a little carrot in front of you. But what it does is it kind of alleviates the stress on your shoulder. I love it because of moments like this, and I just sort of, when I put that thing on, I kind of don't take it off for a few hours generally, because I just sort of like, it's just, I don't know, it's more of a pain in the butt to take it off anyway as well. but also, it just allows me to sort of not feel like the need to ever stop. And I think the actors also love that as well, this idea that we can just keep going, or, you know, we don't need to call cut, we can just kind of go again. All these different things are enabled because I'm not a strong guy.
We need to save our backs. You have got a long career ahead of you, so you don't want to throw your back out too soon.
Yeah, that's true.
let's get back to your choice to not use a lot of equipment, and especially on exteriors, because there is a temptation in a sunny, hot place like Miami, and working with dark-skinned actors as well, there's a temptation or an inclination I think a lot of DPs would have to try their very best to control light, to soften it, to fly large silks overhead, or to add light to people with darker complexions to combat the contrast that they're getting in the natural environment. And you did something very bold. You chose not to do that, nor did you add fill light, which is another option. Always probably something I would do is just bounce a little something back, right? Mm-hmm. But you chose not to, and you made that kind of a steadfast
rule.
For
the most part, yeah. I mean, we cheated sometimes here and there, but you're not wrong. We felt like, again, going back to this authentic concept that is important for Barry and I to sort of look at the image and sort of feel like that's a genuine thing we're watching. Light obviously plays a role in that. And in addition to that, also the city of Miami is a really big part of why the movie looks the way it does. I mean, you set that story in Seattle, and it feels very different. And so that was very important for us, as it always is with Barry and I. For example, not to get too off tangent, but our first film that played at TIFF years back, Medicine for Melancholy, that takes place in San Francisco. It's a very different looking movie, if anybody's seen pieces of it. And it's not like we grew as filmmakers so much, or, I mean, we did, obviously, on some level, but I think the choice as to why that movie looks the way it does and why Moonlight looks the way it does has a lot to do with how Barry and I digest location and how important location is for us. And so the choice to sort of not diffuse and allow the heat of Miami to sort of take root in the images and allow the sheen on people's faces and all those things to sort of ring true to the heat in the space of the city itself. That's critical not only to, you know, things we enjoy and we engage with, but also the story. I mean, the movie, if this movie looked soft and delicate, I don't know that anybody, we wouldn't be standing here. You guys would not be here. We wouldn't be talking about this movie right now. It's the intensity and it's the authenticity, and it's that sort of power that raw light has, I think, is a big part of it.
Your colorist, I read an interview with him, and he said, I knew we were going to be doing something visually aggressive, that's what he called it, because you wanted to push the contrast and the saturation.
Yeah, it's funny, you know, I know that a lot of folks these days are really into, like, the low contrast and, like, this lifted black thing, and that's really cool, I get it. I just can't engage with it personally. It's not my cup of tea. And there's no disrespect. I get it. It's cool and it's very popular and a lot of music videos love it. And it's not, I just really love sharpness and I love contrast. I just think there's a power to it that, again, like, let's apply that, like, low contrast look to Moonlight. It would just be a disaster. So you know, I think it's important to sort of be conscious of what's not just cool or popular, and really pay attention to, you know, what a story wants from you and what, you know, how to be sensitive to that is kind of a big part of being a cinematographer.
Do you think shooting in a place that's not your home or not a place that's familiar to you helps you come up with that language?
It's interesting because I'm from San Francisco, so the first time it was my city and the second time it was Barry's city. Which is funny. There is a big part of being not from somewhere where everything looks new and fresh and engaging. It's a different perspective. Yeah, I don't know. I guess the truth of it, the honest truth is, I don't know that either one is better. I think that you just approach it differently. There's something about our first film, Medicine for Melancholy, that, you know, me being local to that place, I saw it in a way that I think a local sees it. I think there's a lot of people talking when the movie came out. It just felt like a very local's perspective of the film. And that's also because Barry lived there and Barry, really engaged with the city in a serious way. But also because I was around and we would find locations that maybe, you know, if you weren't from there, you wouldn't know about. In the same way that Barry, you know, found locations in Miami that no one else would have known about. So I think, it's interesting. I think the third film, I'll know how to answer that question better because it would probably be in a place that neither of us are from.
And a question that's come up before, I know for you, is capturing that heat. And I would love to talk about the product that you found along in collaboration with the makeup artists. Mm-hmm. To apply to the actor's skin and how that picked up light.
Yeah, Donnie was our makeup artist. She's amazing. She does such a good job. So we did some tests in pre-production right before we started shooting and did plenty of different products. The one we ended up choosing, I think, was called Rosehip, which maybe people know about. I think it's not even just like a movie thing. It's just like
It's a beauty thing.
It's a beauty thing, yeah. So that was what we used. It just seemed to sort of have a sheen and this quality that had this reflectivity it wasn't like greasy. It didn't look like, it wasn't like ugly and like dripping. It was just this really elegant, beautiful shine that allowed this their beautiful skin to sort of register on camera in a way that we just felt was like, that looks perfect. Just use that. So that was it. I mean, it was definitely, you know, Barry jokes a lot about it being a no powder show. Like, there was no powder ever on set for any actor ever.
Also very bold.
Yeah, I mean, that, but, you know, that's important. I think, obviously for Barry, because he's from there, for me as well, I just wanted to represent that city and those people in a really honest, touching way. And yeah, if it was all matte and like soft, it would just be stupid, I think.
It would feel false. You'd have
it
that
feeling.
It
would be feel false, yeah.
Every day you would have that feeling.
And also, I don't think it would be like is like, there's a beauty to those people's faces that I think is really important to understand. And that skin that is really critical to not only the movie, but I think our cultural conscience about sort of how we represent darker skin. In a, I don't know, just in a, because you can go different ways. I mean, I wouldn't do that look if it was a comedy. We'd be changing things, but at the same time, if we chose to make it, I don't know, look matte or something like that, it would just be weird. Mm-hmm. I think.
So. And on that note, what kind of conversations did you have with Barry about? Just general conversations about representation of race in cinema.
It's funny, you know. It's funny. So Barry and I, a little backstory. We went to college together. We grew up. We we're older now. We learned to make movies together. And so I'm white. Newsflash. But because I had this relationship with him really early on, I've been really lucky to start making movies at the very beginning of how I learned to make movies with people of a darker hue. And so it was not really a conversation. I guess it just, I hate to say that. I wish we had a couple like fun conversations about that stuff. My relationship with Barry in this way, it didn't need to be talked about, to be honest with you. Mm-hmm. We have a closeness and a connection both with filmmaking and without that I think it just didn't need to be discussed, to be totally honest with mm-hmm. you. I mean, I have my own personal feelings about it all, obviously, but to be candid, I don't know that we... it was very critical for us to represent skin in a way that we both agreed on, and that's sort of what I spoke about a minute ago. But outside of that, we didn't sort of have, you know, long conversations about what it meant to do that. It just felt good and felt right, and it felt, like, true. I think that was what was important. It wasn't a reaction to anything socio-politically. It was just, let's make this an honest story and let's do this. We'll present it this way because it just feels good.
Yeah. It sounds like it was a very instinct-driven project and possibly collaboration from the very beginning. You mentioned that the two of you just sort of gravitated towards one another as young film students, and so the rest is kind of history with every decision thereafter.
Yeah, I guess I've been really lucky in that sense. I mean, I've not had to have that conversation with Barry because we connect in a way that's very deep and honest, and so... there doesn't need to be something that, like, we don't need to get into it, really.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's awesome. I would love to show a clip. We talked a little bit about the hot Miami sun and things like that. So this is a clip where Chiron, as little, is learning to swim.
Oh, cool.
Awesome. And maybe we can talk a little bit about the sort of all the things that were thrown at you that day, unexpected logistical things afterwards.
Cool.
Your head, rest in my hand. Relax. I got you, I promise. I'm not gonna let you go. Hey, man, I got you. There you go. 10 seconds. See that right there? You're in the middle of the world. That's good. You like that? More athletic. ready. Then we got a swimmer. You wanna try? You ready to swim? Go.
Cool. I love that scene.
James, what can you tell us about shooting that scene?
Cool. So there's lots to talk about. My favorite part of that, there's a whole story about it, but one of my favorite parts about working with Barry, and it's a perfect example of it, is he does this thing where he puts both his cast and his crew in a scenario in which that has to come out. We're both like very physical folks. Like he played sports, I played sports. Like I love being on my feet and interacting with people. And he's there. He's not back at the tent and stuff like that. So, physicality is actually a big part of our process. And when we chose to actually go in the Atlantic Ocean with a camera, and not in like a tank in Hollywood or something like that, that's exactly what happens. You can't help but get the camera in the water, get it close to the actors, fight the tides and fight the waves, and you just end up, and you know, I was more tired than I've ever been in my life after that day. But it was a choice to do that, and he does it over and over again. I think he's brilliant in that way. It's a really cool thing. It's sort of like you can't help but do what we did on some level, by which the choice of, you know, conceptually approaching it in a way that you put up barriers, you put up physical things in front of you that just engage with the camera in a way that, like I said, you just sort of, it's like this comes out. It's not as if there's any other way to do that. If you just put a camera in the ocean, it's kind of what happens. I hate to be so simple, but it's sort of part of what Barry does really well, I think, is sort of present scenarios to his cast, his crew, that inspire moments like that. Does that make sense? Sorry, that's a weird idea, but it's true.
It's amazing. No, it's because when you just set the stage like that, certain things just become inevitable, and they'll be what they had to be.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, there's other examples of it in the movie too, but that's a great one. The backstory, that, and I guess a little bit more about how this happened was, we scheduled, like, that was supposed to be like a six-hour scene. And then, like, Barry being from Miami, we get there that morning, he looks out off the ocean, and, like, there's a massive storm coming, and you can see it. And he's like, okay, we have, like, an hour and a half. And so we just grab the camera, put it in the housing, and I walked out there to the ocean, and sort of, we just started rolling. And we would do these, like, just take after take after take, you know, and occasionally I had to bring the camera out for technical reasons to, like, wipe the lens or reload or things like that. But the idea was just to make that hour and a half, as engaging as possible. And, you know, so there was no choice but to, like, you know, for example, there's no, like, shot from the beach that we, on a long lens, as we look out at them in the ocean. It was all about, and going back to this immersive idea, you know, getting the camera in the water, having the camera and therefore also the audience experience this swimming lesson, so to speak, in the same way that the character is. So again, that was like this setup conceptually that sort of, like I said, kind of this just sort of happens inside of.
But I love the contrast of, like, there is an urgency to it. There's a frenetic quality, but yet the performances are very calm.
It's interesting, yeah. I mean, I have to sort of shout out Mahershala for that a little bit. I think if I remember correctly, I think Barry even told him, hey, listen, we have an hour and a half. I need you to kind of, like, you know, let's throw the script away a little bit. It's not totally true. A lot of the lines that are in there were in the script, and no, I think not all of them, maybe. But, you know, it was like Mahershala helped this kid, and I think Mahershala really shepherded Alex out there. And genuinely, what you're watching in that scene is a kid who genuinely cannot swim. genuinely get a swimming lesson on camera. You know, and it's amazing. And I think it's interesting, too. A little backstory. I think I can say this. It's we're on live Facebook. But I think Mahershala is about to be a dad. And I hope that wasn't a thing that I should have said. But I'm going to say it anyway.
You're hearing it here first.
Yeah. I think it's a really special moment that, like, you know, he, I'm sure, I don't know when he found out that he was pregnant, but maybe just part of wanting to be a father, there's just a real fatherly connection, almost parental, in that relationship that I just, you know, I can see it in that scene very, very much and very deeply.
The connections feel very authentic between the cast members, for sure, in this film.
Yeah.
I saw this great interview with, I've forgotten his name, but the young Chiron. He says, Chiron, he talks with his face, not with his mouth, which I thought was awesome. And
yeah, they all
the
do, right? All those Chirons do. They have those eyes are out of control, right? Yeah, they all have these expressions that are just like deep, deep, deep looks. Yeah.
Yeah, like an real old soul, mm-hmm. that guy.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, Mahershala, if I did that. I don't mean to call you out.
We'll celebrate here from Toronto. So let's talk a bit then about adding color to the light, to your single source lighting, and how you made the decision. There are very bold pops of color. Sometimes it's pink, sometimes it's blue, sometimes it's green. And how much of that is decided on set, and how much of that is refined later in post?
Well, it starts on set. You have to. I mean, I think you know, if you guys have been in a digital intermediate suite doing color work, you know the process there really is just about enhancement or shifts of hues and things like that. So you have to sort of give that colorist material to work with. And so, you know, the pink light, you know, the greens, the blues, all those things are obviously they're in production. There's a lot of sodium vapor light, for example, we're using in those night scenes, and we use sodium vapor gels to kind of get us there. I think there's something called super white flame that we at least have in the States. I'm not sure what that, if you guys have it here, but probably do. We're not that far off. So I do use a lot of gels on lights. There's also really cool stuff, like our gaffer, Kiva Knight, who's an amazing young man. He had this one light gear light. That it's a, I can't remember what it's called, it's like a, not bicolor, it's like a, some other thing where you can, almost like a sound mixing board, sort of shift hues on this little funny thing that he had.
That's cool.
Yeah, and so I would always ask for that, because I knew if he set that up, we could sort of be very playful, for example, the pink light you see back there is something that was experimented with on set. And, you know, I remember Barry and I sort of standing with our arms crossed in that hallway, sort of like, more pink, more blue. More. And he could do it, and we're just dialing it in. And so a lot of that's done on set. And then in post with our colorist, Alex Bickle, who's so freaking talented. So I think it's my 7th film with Alex. He's a really great guy. He is, I think, the best. And he did a great job in, you know, manipulating the colors we gave him to sort of enhance or, you know, subdue or shift here and there. We also use a lot of, like, you know, a different film LUT, for example, which are this weird technical thing that you do in post where you can sort of emulate what a film stock would do from previous decades or modern ones, or there's all these different choices you can make. It's like Instagram or whatever. So we chose ones that felt right and did what we wanted to do in the first act. Is that we used a Fuji LUT, for example, that has enhancements of the greens and blues, and then in the second act we did an old Agfa LUT that sort of has this sort of pastel quality to it, and then the third we're Kodak, and it has like a warmth, kind of orangey, warm skin tone vibe to it as well. So we sort of chose ones according to what we sort of wanted to enhance, depending on what the character was going through emotionally. And so, you know, it's a bit of both is the answer. You know, I try to sort of get as far as I can on set, And then, but I also do, I kind of love the doing the DIs. It's kind of one of my favorite parts of the process. So I do spend time in there, and we do kind of a lot of manipulation.
Let's take a look at those clips. Sure. There's the hallway clip with the magenta light we're talking about, and there's also a scene from his teenage years.
In the sink.
With the sink. The ice sink.
That flicker was hard to get, actually. We had to, like, the lights we're using for that scene are movie lights. They're like these LED things, and it took us forever to sort of get the flicker to work properly, actually. We actually had to end up adding a flicker box to it that is usually used to, like, make firelight flicker light stuff. And it's funny, some people think it's a mistake, but it took a while to figure that out.
It's a great effect. I think this film's full of... just so many memorable visual moments. I often think, like, you know, if you can get away with like one or two of them in a movie, this goes for any movie you love and watch. Like, if you can leave an audience with one or two of them, like, you've done your job. This film's just like packed full of them, and that flicker is certainly part of it. I think for me,
thanks.
It's the combination of what's happening in the scene and then the intensity of your work on it technically.
Yeah, there's a bit about it. It's funny. Flicker is a new thing, right? I feel like now it's popular. It used to not get away with it for a while. But there's something about it that they're like it just kind of messes with you in a weird mental way there's something about it to me that just sort of really kind of I don't know what it does.
It's unsettling.
It's very you're right. It is unsettling.
Yeah,
that's a good way to put it. Yeah. It's true.
It's a good choice. Yeah, for such an unsettling moment. Let's talk a little bit more.
Yeah, cool.
Let's talk about. I want to talk more about your career at large.
Sure.
Cool. Before we open it up to the floor. Yeah. So mm-hmm. we already know. We already know that you were a film student at Florida State University with Barry
mm-hmm.
Jenkins.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us a little bit about like some of your earlier work together, and also I want to hear about some of the other projects that you worked with other directors mm-hmm. as well. And
It's funny. This year's a funny year. I have Moonlight. It's on like the best list of some folks this year. And then I have Yoga Hosers on the worst list of some folks, which is a really funny thing.
Hits and misses.
Yeah. Which is good. I feel good about that. That's a cool thing for me. I've worked with a number of filmmakers. Lots of them have been sort of first-time filmmakers. My sort of growth in the industry has come out of doing movies for like no money. Like Medicine Melancholy, we made for $15,000. Oh, wow. The movie we made it for that was for $100,000. And after, I mean, it's sort of like I just kind of climbing that sort of budgetary ladder for a while. That was like the sort of 2007 to 2013. I was in debt and broke and just doing little independent films for a long time. And then it's been easier recently, but it took a while. That's sort of the background of where I come out of is doing like really small films, really, really small films. It's been growing and trying to sort of navigate that in a business way, which is sort of a funny thing to talk about. But that's sort of my background a little bit. I mean, before that, a little context to it as well. I'm sort of one of those kids that everyone hates because I do have a parent in the business. And so I grew up on set a little bit, not a little bit, a lot. my mom is a costume designer and a rather successful one. So she has had a crazy career. And so I was always like on Christmas breaks and summer breaks and things like that, you know, going to fly to meet mom wherever she was in the world. And, you know, she would say, you know, we'd come to set with me. And, you know, in the morning we'd go to set and she'd drop me, say, come to the back of the camera truck and say, hey, take care of this kid. And I'd go and sort of sit on cases and watch them work and things like that. So I did sort of fall. I do have a little bit of a context to how I came into the business. I sort of fell into it as a child and got really interested in it. First, oddly enough, as, you know, when you're 12 or 10 or that age or whatever it is, you sort of are fascinated by this massive machine and these departments that are exchanging ideas, and the cast comes on set, everybody starts whispering. Is this kind of amazing thing? As a kid, that was like really fascinating for me. And then later, it was like the camera department has all these toys. Like, I'll go hang out with those guys. And then it, you know, at sort of 15, 16, was like, oh, then there's stories. Got it. Okay, cool. And so, like, that was my trajectory into sort of wanting to go to film school. I also went to, like, an arts-focused high school, which is terrible, of a terrible education. But but I did... I did get to do art stuff for, like, the way it worked was almost like a major where we did, like, academics in the morning, and after lunch you had your discipline, and my discipline was film video. You could do painting or dance or different things like that. So so I can't spell, but I can make pictures.
it's another kind of writing.
Yeah, yeah. So that's my sort of background history a bit. And then I met Barry in college, and we sort of had this really immediate connection that, you know, I think we just sort of, I don't know, sort of, we, I think kind of needed each other on some weird level. And I think he was really interested in the kind of films that I'd brought from San Francisco, my little DVD collection of Criterion Collection DVDs, and we'd watch them. And I think he sort of was like, what is this white kid from San Francisco all about? And I sort of, then we started like kind of engaging and talking about, you know, these weird movies that we were watching, these sort of like Wong Kar Wai films or Ho Chau Shun films or these French New Wave films, Godard or whatever. And I think, I don't know, I have to ask him. My guess is he was just like confused as to who I was, maybe a little bit, but in a fun way. And we got along really, really well. And, you know, just started collaborating pretty quickly in that time. And you know, it's funny, those the same influences we had, you know, I graduated college in 2003, and I think are still present in Moonlight. It's weird. I'm not sure we've evolved that much.
It's sort of like an artist's body of work, though, will just expand on itself. It's not like each project is necessarily its own isolated incident, because you're still dealing with the same aesthetics, the same themes in your own life. You still have your taste, which is central to you.
Mm. Yeah, it's interesting. This idea of voice is something I'm really curious about right now and trying to figure out. And the things that I'm sort of personally going through right now and trying to understand how this happened with Moonlight and why I'm here right now talking to you guys is a bizarre thing for me, but a cool thing. And so where my mind is currently is, like, why did Moonlight mean so much to me? Which is then asking myself, well, who am I? What value system do I personally have, and why that connected with the story in a certain way? And that's actually the most interesting thing I'm kind of personally going through currently, is trying to understand how one's personal voice as a cinematographer, because we don't write movies, I don't direct movies, I don't develop them, I photograph them, but somehow I am integral, and my gaze, whoever I am as a human being, comes out, has to. And the way I see Chiron is about not only Barry, it's a lot about Barry, but it's also about me. And that's an interesting thing to sort of figure out and kind of like rattle around in my brain, because for a long time I sort of always felt like my job was to just sort of disappear into story and disappear my work into what the director's vision might be, and try to like adapt who I am. And I realized that was a terrible idea recently. And I sort of have, I think, you know, if I'm going to speak for myself for a second about myself, I think, you know, I'm a very sort of passive person generally. And I've tended, I think, for a long time to sort of not value my own perspectives. I'm going through therapy right now.
This is therapy.
And I think that's a really important thing to mention. One of the things I wanted to pass along to you guys in this room today was I think that's really critical to not devalue yourself. Even as a cinematographer, you are really important. And try to think about that. Like, think about who you are, where you come from. You guys are in Toronto. That should mean something. How you see the world is really, really important. And please be conscious of that, you know, when you approach a film. It's probably the biggest deal, I think.
There is a tendency, you hear about it a lot with young DPs saying, like, well, I just need to be a chameleon. I'm a hired gun, exactly. Sort of thing. But that's impossible, actually.
I think it is impossible. It's a funny thing. I don't know why, whoever made that up. I want to talk to them. it's something that is taught through university all the time in film school. You're absolutely right. That even the way you said it is how it was said to me. And I just can't disagree more now with that idea. It's really, really important, I think, to think. It's important to think about it and then digest it and then present it. But even just conceptually, it's really messed up to not feel like you're integral to the process. It's sort of, I'm getting upset.
and on that same note, like knowing when you might not have so much to offer to a project.
Yeah, sure, exactly. Not every project, not every story is going to necessarily be a match for you. And that's something that I'm going through right now. There's some wonderful stories out there that, you know, just aren't quite right for me, and that's okay. And it's really, I think it's important to understand that even if you like the story a lot or like the people a lot, maybe they don't want your vision. And I think to understand that is important.
What happens now when someone says, I want you to do what you did, but for this script that you might not connect with?
Sure. It is tough. Yeah, I mean, there's two answers to that. One is that, like, I don't want to do the same thing, obviously. No one wants to repeat their work on anything as an artist. I mean, I think that goes for cast, that goes for everybody involved. But that's different than voice. Voice is a more sort of, like, through-line concept. But when a project approaches me that doesn't have, you know, doesn't want my value system even, or who I am as a person, I kind of think I sort of say, yeah, thank you very much. That's very nice of you. I just don't know that this is right. I think of sort of, it's weird. I'm 36. I feel like I should know myself. But I feel like I only recently have figured it out, which is weird.
Some people never get challenged that way, though, right?
That's so true. I've been coasting for a long time. I think that's someone, I think we can, you know, all understand it as people. It took a challenge to, and it, I think it always, you're right, it always does. It seems to always work out that way, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. You the challenges somehow allow you to see yourself and figure yourself out. Mm-hmm.
Mm. Were there moments on this set that you felt connected to that, like, 20-year-old you, or you and Barry being like, this is just like that time, and then you knew it was
every
like
day.
The right? Yeah.
Yeah. No, I think most days were like that, which, yeah, I think my knees didn't feel the same way. But no, yeah, I mean, like, you know, when Bear and I are together, and I think that goes for, you know, there's probably a lot of best friends in this room. When you guys are together, it does sort of feel like a bit timeless, you know. I hope that we live to be 80 and probably feel the same way, you know. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. There's a temptation to try to, like, recreate that with every new collaboration, but
it's tough. Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, I think that's about, yeah, that what you're speaking to is not just about filmmaking, but about relationships, period. I mean, you know, a marriage or a girlfriend or a boyfriend or whatever, like those things that, they're so meaningful and they're so specific to that rapport. They can't be repeated. And, you know, sometimes you let them go and sometimes you hold on.
So let's open up the questions. Oh, there's many. I saw the you in the white shirt. Your hand shot right up. So let's do this first.
First off, thanks so much for doing this. This is amazing.
Thank you. No, thank you.
My friend Nabil and I, we're actors. Mm. We just co-directed our first short film.
Congrats.
Thank you. We learned totally on the fly. And we work with the DP, and he was amazing, very experienced. And he said, okay, well, you should do a shot list. And we're like, what the hell is a shot? Don't you do that? And he's like, no, you do that. So I have kind of a micro version of the same question. The first is, now that you're on this grander scale, do you have more creative control where you may actually have an input in like something like a shot list, things like that? And secondly, on a more macro level, do you have any tips for new coming directors on how to avoid the pitfalls through communication with cinematographers? So like, what would you like from a director and how to communicate with you to have the vision?
Well, I think the first thing about shot list stuff, it's interesting. I think everyone's different, right? Some directors will storyboard their whole thing in their bedroom by themselves, and they'll get real specific, and some people show up with nothing on the page, and they figure it out on the day. So there's a massive spectrum by which people's process work. But, you know, I guess, so saying that, for me, what I've done in the past, I don't know that, yeah, I think every director I've worked with has shared that time with me, actually. So I've sat down with them and shot-listed the film before. That's been my personal experience. By no means does that mean that's right or wrong. It just means that that's been what I've done. So sometimes it's a shared thing, actually. I like that because then I get to sort of feel like my like I said before, talked about before, my voice and my vision is sort of somewhere in there finding itself. And I don't know how if I didn't have that opportunity, I've yet to have that idea. I've yet to have that challenge, but so I don't know the answer as to how I would otherwise figure that out. So sorry, does that answer your question? That's the first bit, and then the whole idea of like what I want to get. It's funny. I don't know if this is true because I've never been an actor, but I think that I like being directed like an actor on some level, actually, because I like to both get specific notes if I need them, if that's the functionality of the relationship. But sometimes I also like to give, like, you know, tonal notes. And if I even like sort of abstract ideas and directions that maybe don't get to the heart of it. Like, for example, the swimming scene we watched and just the idea that, like, this conceptualizing of the conceptual process that we sort of approach physically, you know, I think both worked for Mahershala, for example, but it also worked for me. I think so. I'd like to be manipulated. I like to be told specifically what needs to happen. I guess I like all of it, but I do like direction. I hate not getting it. I'll say that. I do want it. I do need it, actually. Yeah.
So my question is about the collaborative process. Earlier you were talking about how in film school or whoever told you that the cinematographer is supposed to be like a chameleon or whatever. I think that's bullshit, but... Mm-hmm. Oh, shoot, sorry. well, when I studied film at Carleton University, the professors would emphasize that on every level, there's a different voice, although they're aiming for the same goal. You have the screenwriter, the director, producers, and then you have the cinematographers, et cetera. Sometimes they're the same people in different roles. But I was wondering if you could tell us if there was maybe a single shot or moment in the movie where you felt like your vision screamed out the loudest. Mm. Or you felt like you really took the reins on that moment. Mm-hmm. I was wondering if you could elaborate.
It's funny, yeah. I wish I could answer. I wish there was a better answer for this, but I have to say I don't think there was. And that's not to say that I was passive in it. It's just that at least in this specific movie, my process with Barry is one that it's really hard to understand whose idea it was. And I think that's a sign of a good relationship, actually. I think it's when it's clear that, like, oh, that was my idea and I take ownership of that shot, I kind of feel like that's a sign that maybe it's not a great relationship in a weird way. That could also not be true, by the way. It just seems like maybe that's true for the way Barry and I are. So there were choices that I made, no doubt, but I don't credit them to myself in a way that, like, makes it feel separate. I guess, in my opinion, even though I just talked about voice being so important, and it is, I also at the same time understand my role in the process, and I realize that I'm still making the director's movie too, So it's a so in that respect, there isn't necessarily a thing that I could sort of point to and say, this is me or this is mine. And I hold on to that. I think I'm making choices constantly, as we all are, but they're ones that always have this sort of overarching understanding of, you know, where I, what my role is still understood for me. Sorry. I know that's sort of a non-answer, but yeah.
Sure. Hi. Thanks so much for being here. I'm right in front of you.
You are.
My question is about the, you mentioned for filming that swimming lesson scene, mm-hmm. like, and that you and Barry have this like really physical, you know, quality, and like it requires a lot of physicality to be on your crew, I would imagine, or like on the stripped down mm-hmm. part that needs to be filmed, like totally. There for that scene.
Totally.
Do you have hesitations about bringing women into your crews in the That's future? Cool. Do you have questions? Like, do you, no. you know, have any like tips yeah. or advice for other women on set who have to like endure, like, you know, maybe they can't put up with the same like kind of physicality that
gotcha.
Men do?
So. I have zero hesitations about it. I had an all-female camera crew back, and it was in October. I did a television pilot in Los Angeles. I had a complete female camera crew from top to bottom. Wait, that's not true. I had a DIT that was a guy. But my first AC, her name is Jacqueline Leslie. She's amazing. I watched her carry a Alexa with a 24-290 up a hill that I could barely walk up as a man, as a guy. So I don't think there's anything physically that makes a woman not able to sort of engage with me in a physical way that I sort of would be asking for. And she's skinny and small. I was super impressed. I mean, I took a picture of her on my iPhone because I was like, what is happening right now? So... So by no means do I think that that's a challenge or something that I need to sort of consider. I don't. The truth is, I think some of my favorite filmmakers are women. Actually, I think not to get too theoretical here, but it's a sort of thing. There's a feminine. It's a weird. I shouldn't even talk about it this way, but I will because it's embarrassing anyway. But I think that cinema generally there's a femininity to it that. I think is sort of important to mention and talk about a little bit, like as a medium. You know, I have a feminine side to myself, and that sort of comes out when I'm working. And not to speak for Barry, but I think he does too. That's not exactly what you're talking about, but I think that's something to mention as well.
Hi, I was just curious if you could maybe, you talked about how you made lots of mistakes before. But you're sitting in front of a room of young filmmakers who are going to make plenty of mistakes. Mm-hmm. Is there any stories you'd like to share so maybe we can learn from yours?
Well, mistakes as a cinematographer are interesting because they're kind of conceptual, like, I'm not a focus puller, so a mistake for focus pullers is when it's out of focus, or when the slate is wrong, the second AC is at fault. Or like, there's different things that are actual mistakes for other parts of the camera department or other departments. You forget the prop or whatever. It's a mistake for the prop master or whatever. But for cinematographers, mistakes are bizarre because they're not really their choices, right? So the wrong choice is, I guess, what I was speaking to when I said I've made mistakes. And wrong approaches, like this scene should feel hand. In my mind, I would say, "Oh, this scene should feel handheld and sort of gritty or intense and long lens and sort of whatever." And then when I watch the film later, I realize, "Gosh, what was I doing? That was should have been a very quiet moment that should have felt very kind of natural and fluid or whatever." And so I think that's what I'm speaking to about mistakes in a way. I guess, I don't know if I can think of one in a movie. I mean, you guys haven't even seen my movies probably, so it's a little. if I can think of one. There's a movie called Adult World that I did a long time ago that Scott Coffey, the director, and I he's amazing. I love Scott. But I think I made some mistakes in the movie, actually. It's a funny story. That story, on a script level, is something of almost like it's a bit poppy. It's a bit like kind of candy and fun. And and Scott and I, when talking about the movie, wanted to sort of have it rooted in a sort of realistic thing. And I think that's just where Scott and I come from as filmmakers and people. I'm not sure if I even talked to Scott about this, so maybe he's watching, I'm not sure. But I don't know that was right, actually. I kind of think we made a wrong choice there aesthetically. That I think we're too involved with ourselves and who we were, and maybe it wasn't the right choice. Anyway, so that's kind of what I'm talking about mistakes-wise.
I just want to say first, thank you for working on something that was so beautiful and humane.
Thank you.
And for a lot of us that are up-and-coming filmmakers, how it's touching for us to see facets of ourselves for the first time on screen, and how a lot of us have probably been supporting it since the premiere at TIFF back in September.
Thank you.
So thank you for that. My question was, I know you shot, I'm assuming, solely on anamorphic. Yeah. I was wondering how your choice of lenses was effective of how you ended up getting the look of the movie.
Cool. Thank you very much, by the way. That's very nice of you. So the choice of anamorphic was massive for us. It was conceptually about, I'm not sure what you guys' associations with anamorphic lenses are, but for me, I associate them with like Marvel movies or like Star Wars and Star Trek and things like that. That's kind of my association with images that are photographed that way. And what our idea was okay, let's place a mass, like let's engage with an audience on a visual level, that scope and that elevation of ideas that those movies seem to do almost. There's like there's a supernaturalness to them. There's a massive like explosions of scope in them. And let's apply that to a story about a community that's never been represented that way. And the hope was to present that story, which is sort of nuanced and quiet and subtle and those things, but speak to them as really important moments. So that's what the idea was conceptually, was sort of that idea. Because when you read the script and when you tell the story, all these little like moments in between things, there's lots of space between dialogues, there's looks, there's glances at people's eyes and things like that. And while they may not speak to the same things as Mars exploding and how important that would be, or Earth is dying, or what are these things that these massive films have, they seem to, on an emotional level for me and for Barry, and I think the rest of the group, and hopefully the audience as well, is feel that same or more emotionally massive in that sense. I'm being very long-winded. The idea for the lenses was about that, was to present these small things on a really big scale. Yeah.
In the back.
Hi. Because you're operating yourself on the film, do you find that there is a difference in the visual abstraction you're getting from the script as opposed to if you're giving a DP or having had the directions given to you?
I'm sorry, I'm going to clarify a little bit. You're asking.
Okay, so you're operating the camera yourself, I'm guessing, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so is there a different visual abstraction that you're achieving from the script from doing that as opposed to having someone operate the camera for you on shoots?
Completely. Yeah, for sure. There's something about this idea of voice we're talking about coming through because of that choice to operate, I think. I think Moonlight is a great example of it. There's many other filmmakers that do this. We're not the only ones, but we make choices, I think, on very gut instinctual levels when we're on set and when in pre-production or whatever. We're deciding about cameras, we're deciding about light, all these things based around, you know, what feels good, what feels right, what feels appropriate. And so if I'm sitting at a monitor, and there's a couple camera operators or camera operator operating for me, I unless I've worked with them for 30 years and they know me so well, they know what I like, it's going to be impossible for that gut level choices to sort of find themselves on screen. I don't know how to do that another way. You can get specific and, you know, once a take happens, you can go and give them notes and say, at this moment when he does this thing, do this or other things. But there's nothing like sort of being present, listening, hearing, and seeing the actors perform and registering what's going on an emotional level in your brain and then making choices that feel right about that. So does that answer your question? Yeah, there's a massive difference, actually, I think, between when you're operating and when you're not. Some are good for other things. You know, if for example, with Kevin Smith, I don't operate because he does two cameras. And when there's two cameras, I have a sort of a rule about that. I don't like to operate myself if there's more than one camera, because what happens, was at least happened to me in the past, is it ends up being like two movies. You know, one camera looks one way, one camera's making one choices, like I'm doing certain things, and then the operator, even if someone that I love and got on the job because I like what they do, it's sort of inevitable. On a different project, it would make sense that I don't operate. But with Moonlight, especially because of how much perspective is so critical to the film, it was important for me to operate, you know, with the exception of Steadicam.
Right here in the front. I'm so sorry. We'll get to your question next.
Hi. Thank you so much.
No problem.
It's been a very informative session. This film reminds me of Wonkar Wai's In the Mood for Love because of the colors and contrasts. Mm. So my question is, how do you transform the psyche behind the color in your vision? Mm. How do you take that into the screen?
Yeah, so it's funny. There's it's a good question. They are many DPs, you know, that they've read books about this that like have color theories about yellow means something and red means something. I don't necessarily subscribe to that personally. We could talk about that for hours, but like I just don't know that that's something that I actually believe in. Not to dismiss it, because for some people it's really valuable, and I appreciate that very much. But for me in my work, I don't think, for example, I can't tell you that like green in the movie meant something, because I don't think it did. That was a choice about Miami being Miami and choosing locations that spoke to this aesthetic that we were interested in.
So how do you choose that color? That if it is green, why it is green?
So I think a better question might be like, why the pink light's pink, right? Like why do we choose that color in pink? And I think, because the green is nature and I can't control that. That's sort of what it is. Mm-hmm. But the pink light or the color blue in the moonlight scenes, mm-hmm. for example, there's a bit of green in there, for example. Yeah. And I think those colors that you're asking about, how do you choose that? Mm-hmm. That's about asking yourself who you are and who I am and what that color meant to me and why it meant that to me. Mm-hmm. And that's something that might not even be verbalized. To talk about why that pink felt right to us in that moment, there's probably a thousand reasons as Barry and I crossing arms like this and sort of choosing that in the hallway. I think he's processing something, I'm processing something. We're playfully playing with that sort of mixing board of color. And I think all the choices, you know, for me, I'll say all the choices for me. I think Barry's much more intellectual than I am. He's much smarter as well. That for me, I make choices on a gut sort of level, and that pink, it spoke to me in a way that felt appropriate to the moment. Okay. I know that's sort of a non-answer, but it is honest. It is sort of how I make choices. It's about a personal thing that it clicks, mm-hmm. and I go, yep, stop, and that's it, yeah.
Okay, thank you so much.
No problem.
I have a two-part question. Mm-hmm. The first part is it hard coming off of a project as big as Moonlight with such a great response to it? And then the second question is, you're talking about when you read a script, you see if it clicks with your values. And I was wondering, what are the kind of things that stand out to you when you're reading a script and you just think, I want to do that?
Hard? I don't think it's hard to come off of. I mean, it's kind of amazing to come off of Moonlight in a way. It's confusing, I'll be honest. It is emotionally, it's bizarre. In movies before, I was being myself just as I was with this film. And so that's a funny thing to sort of understand and figure out. But But no, it's not hard. I mean, I did take a little bit of a break. I was tired. Something we talked about before, and something I think I really think is important now is for me to sort of want to give as much as I gave to Moonlight on the next film again. And I mean that mentally and physically. Like, I was wrecked when I left Miami. And I think I want that feeling again. I don't want to do a movie that I'm not wrecked after again. I think it's important to want that and want to give that. So, which is what also speaks to this idea of how important it is to choose the right project again. Because if you're wrecking yourself for something that doesn't mean something to you, that's sort of maybe a waste of not just yours, but everyone else's time as well. And I'm sorry, the second part of it was about values and how to sort of
what I see.
Yeah, so it's tough. I think for me, what I personally am engaged with is that I'm engaged with stories that speak like Moonlight, like other films as well, speak to presenting, people, whatever race, creed, or whatever. That, like, you know, it digs deeper maybe than before previous films, or explores a new sort of culture or something that, because I'm a white dude. Like, I am in the majority. I'm in power. I'm all these things that's also super boring for me. So I'm engaged in exploring other people, you know, other folks. I think that's something that I'm on a personal level engaged with, and I want to understand them. I want to understand where they come from and who they are and what they're like. So that's sort of an answer. You know, I guess I'm just looking for different experiences in that sense.
And unfortunately, that had to be our last question from the audience. Sorry about that, everybody. But thank you for this wealth of knowledge you've already imparted today. And thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much. Thank you, guys. Thanks for hanging out.
Thank you all for coming. And good luck, and we all wish you continued success.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Thanks, guys.
And thank you, Maya. Thank you. Awesome. And thank you, James. We'll be cheering real hard next weekend. next Sunday, if anyone wasn't clear. That brings us to the end of our day. Thank you so much for your participation and your kindness and your courageousness, and for doing some listening, which I think was amazing for Desmond and Charles to remind us is a really powerful act. So thank you so much for being here. I want to highly recommend the rest of the weekend if you haven't gotten tickets already. We have some really phenomenal films that I think kind of echo a lot of the themes we were talking about today, or at least we aspire for them to. Most of the tickets are free with the exception of two films, so take a chance on us. I'm like thinking of ABBA. The other thing I just want to flag is we're always open to hearing from you. This community is a collaborative one. If you have ideas for things you want to see happening in the building, please reach out. We have something that happens monthly called Film Club. It's kind of like collab, but once a month, and it usually connects to a film playing in the building. We're really open. We love to hear every new idea, and I'm often desperate for them. So please, nextwave@tiff.net, write to us or add your email outside. And please stick around, if not today or this weekend, just in general. We love having you in the building. You mean the world to us. And thank you.